Shalom, 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 shalom. Once again, you're not under the sounds of the voice of your brother. I'm Tazadaq, coming at you through the spirit of Yahweh Shah. I'm through the spirit of God in Christ. And for the record, once again, this is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent counsel. Then please be advised, everything I'm about to give you is strictly for educational, informational, entertainment purposes only. It's not to be taken or misconstrued as legal advice. Therefore, with that being said, if you use any of this information, you fall flat on your face. It's your own fault, because I always encourage everyone to research everything that I'm seeing. So with that being said, let us begin. So I wanted to talk to you about 14th Amendment U.S. citizen, whether or not you was born or whether you was naturalized in the United States. Let's say, for instance, you came from what is referred to as Jamaica, Trinidad, so on and so forth, Spain, and you became naturalized in the United States, or you were born here and you declare yourself as a citizen. And you, when you fill out a job application, if you declare yourself as a U.S. citizen, right? If you declare yourself as being naturalized in the United States, then you are foreclosed and civilly dead. And so you say, well, what are you talking about, Tazadaq? I'm foreclosed. I'm not a house. Well, you are a thing akin to a house. So with that being said, the legal manifestation of this is what? Is that no government, as well as any law, any agency, any aspect, any court, colorable court, or what have you, etc., can actually coerce itself with anything other than a corporate, artificial person and contracts between them. So two things are necessary to be here for you to be deemed foreclosed and civilly dead. You have to be classified as a United States citizen. You have to be classified, which is a corporation, right? Which is a subject. Or an artificial person, which is a subject. And a contract must exist. So that means at some point in time, you consented by way of a contract. Now, the Constitution of the Republic and Acts of Congress made in conformity to the Constitution of the state, whichever state you're in which a corporation, whatever it may be, is actually located, and acts of legislator, should I say, that's actually constitutionally made, together with the common law, as they are actually accepted, or of superior force to any bylaw. That means any statute. That means any code. That means any rule, any regulation, and so on and so forth. Or colorable law. You understand what I'm saying? So the Constitution is superior to these things. The common law is superior to these things, such as statutes, codes, acts, rules, regulations, and so on and so forth. So when contrary to either of them, whether it's contrary to the Constitution and so on and so forth, that is the Constitution of the Republic or the Constitution of the state, these bylaws or these colorable laws are determined to be void. They're without substance. Whenever they conflict with the Constitution of the Republic and the Constitution of the state, they are considered to be void, whether a de facto authorized them, you know, or any such bylaw authorized them, because no legislature can actually grant power larger than they themselves possess. In other words, they don't have power. Legislators don't have power that they don't possess. You understand what I'm saying? All power derived from who? From we, the people. So one who being competent to contract and who is the legal age of majority, another way of saying that is sui juris, one has all the rights to which a people or a free man is actually entitled. One who is not under another one's authority, or as a slave, or as a minor, and the like. That's a free man. That's a creditor. That's someone operating from a sovereign capacity, which is I, man. Now, so let me educate you on some legalese, right? What they refer to as English, but it's a form of English that is actually not taught to you in the public school, but it should be taught to you in the public school. So watch this. Issue. Issue means the first delivery of a bill or a note. That's an issue. Complete in form to a person who takes it as a holder. Bill of Exchange Act, 1882. That's what it comes from. So maxim in law. What is a maxim in law? Maxims don't change, right? Maxims are de jure. And the maxims of law is what comes first, is best in law. Do you understand? Whereas defined percent to the Supreme Court, annotated statute, case law, right? Penn Holloway versus Doan, administrative 3 U.S. So the government scrutiny, the government, or the de facto, should we say, or corporations, in as much as every government is an artificial person, an abstraction, and a creature of the mind only. In reality, it really has no substance. A government can actually interface only with other artificial persons, which is why they're so into getting you to give the name or being the name in court. So the imaginary is what the government really is, right? Having neither actuality nor substance, right? So it is essentially foreclosed from creating and actually attaining partiality with the tangible, right? So the legal manifestation of this is that no government, as well as any law, any agency, any other corporate entity, any artificial person can actually affect us unless we are actually operating under the capacity or of a debtor, which is a artificial person, or a corporation, which is an artificial person, which means we have a contract with them, which means at some point we had to consent. Everything that happens to you is as a result of you consenting. At some time or another, you consent. So when there is an express grant, right, limited to certain cases and for certain purposes, the corporate power of the legislation is confined to the objects specified. So all others being excluded by implication. So the power of making bylaws, where do they get it from? And so when I say bylaws, a bylaw is something like a statute, right? It's a code. It's a rule. It's a regulation. You see what I'm saying? These are bylaws. So these bylaws is to be actually exercised by those persons in whom it is actually vested by the charter. But if that instrument is silent on the subject, it resides in the members of the corporation at large and not in we the people. That's case law, man. That's Harris and Gill versus R 324. That's case law. The Constitution of the United States and acts of Congress made in conformity to it, that the Constitution of the state in which a corporation is located and the acts of the legislator. So constitutionally made together with the common law, as well as accepted, are the superior forces to any bylaw. So the Constitution of the United States, the Constitution of the several states, and the common law is superior to any bylaw, which is a statute, which is a code, which is a rule, which is a regulation. So in such laws, these bylaws, these colorable laws, these statutes, these codes, when contrary to either the Constitution, when contrary to the Constitution of the state, and when contrary to the law, they are void. They are void. Do you understand? This is not according to me. Go and check it out for yourself. Because no legislator, none of these legislators, none of these political powers can grant power larger than they themselves, than what they possess, in other words. That's case law. That's Cohen's R 558. So that's what it is. Now, I said that you were civilly dead if you're a 14th Amendment citizen, whether you was born in the United States or whether you was naturalized in the United States. And by the way, if you're tuning in for the first time, go ahead and subscribe to the channel. And after you subscribe to the channel, make sure you click the notification bell so that you can actually get notifications. I think a lot of people are actually not being notified and you're missing the course. Or you're coming on really late. So, civiliter mortis. What is it? What does it mean? Anyone know? Dork matter? You just saying shalom, 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 huh? Shalom, 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 huh? What is civiliter mortis, right? That means civilly dead. And so if you're a 14th Amendment citizen, that's what you are. You're civilly dead. If you are naturalized, say if you came from Jamaica somewhere and you got naturalized, you're civilly dead. That's one who's considered, you know, as if he were naturally dead. So far as his rights are concerned, which means you don't have any rights. You have something known as privileges. See, a law dictionary, adopted to the Constitution and laws of the United States of America and of the several states of the American Union, according to Bouvier's civiliter mortis, if you are civiliter mortis, then you are civilly dead, which actually means as if you were naturally dead. That's what you're classified as. What is a foreclosure? Is it only on a home? Why did I say that you're foreclosed and civilly dead? What was I talking about? I was talking about the law. All you got to do is read it for yourself. So go and look in Black Law's Dictionary, fourth edition. I always recommend the fourth. Now, after the fourth, I don't think you will find this in there. Go and look up foreclosure, right? Define foreclosure in Black Law's fourth. It means to shut out. Is this not what happened to citizens? They're shut out from rights. They're given privileges to bar, to terminate. So what happens when you become a citizen? You terminate your rights for privileges. That's the state 5 versus Darling. A method of terminating mortgages' right of redemption. So when you become foreclosed, you're terminated any right for redemption. What is incompetency? Yeah, all of these things, why am I teaching you this? Because many of you, when you're going into these colorable courts, you're getting railroaded and you don't understand what's going on. So many times the black role would deem you incompetent, mentally incompetent. So he's saying, hey, this is incompetency. We're going to send you to talk to a psychiatrist. But what exactly is incompetency in law? What does it mean? It means evident. It means the want of legal fitness or ability in a witness to be heard as such on the trial of a cause. So he's saying you're not even competent enough to do this. It's the objections to the competency of a witness or fourfold. The first ground is the want of understanding. A second is defect of religious principles. A third arises from the conviction of certain crimes or infamy of character. The fourth is an account of entrance. So they deem you mentally incompetent, a ward of the court. Because what? Because of incompetency. So notice the agent. So notice the principal. What are we doing? We're learning some legalese, right? What is a principal? Not P-R-I-N-C-P. No, not that. I'm talking P-R-I-N-C-I-P-A-L. Principal, right? Notice to agent is notice to principal, right? Contracts. We're dealing with contracts. All of this is dealing with contracts. So the principal, one, being competent to contract. You understand? And is actually also the legal age of majority, which would also mean that they are suri juris. Employs. It employs another to do an act for his own benefit or on his account. So as a general rule, it may be said that every person, suri juris, is capable of being a principal, right? Now we want to change person to people, one of the people, right? For in all cases where a man has power as owner or in his own right to do anything, he may do it by another. Do you understand? So what exactly is suri juris? Many of you are using these things in your documentation and you don't really know what they mean. You're just using it. Like many of you use UCC 1-308, but you really don't have a clear understanding of what it really means. What does it mean to be suri juris? One who has all the rights to which a free man is entitled. That's someone that's suri juris. One who is not under the power of another. That's suri juris. One that is not a slave. One that is not a minor. One that is the legal age of majority and the like. To make a valid contract, one must be suri juris. A person must be, in general, suri juris to be able to make a valid contract. So everyone of full age is presumed to be suri juris unless you are a U.S. citizen. Do you understand? So priority. What does it mean? Priority. It means going before, opposed to posterity. He who has the presidency in the time has the advantage in right, is the maxim of law, right? First in line, first in time. Not that time, considered barely in itself, can make any such difference, but because the whole power over a thing being secured to one person. So this actually bars all others from attaining a title to it afterward. File your UCC one first, you do a commercial lien, first in line, first in time, that's the law. That bars anyone else from being able to put a lien against your property. As simple as ABC, 1, 2, 3. I lift back. You understand? It's really that simple. But you make it complex. So that's priority. Simple. Principle. Priority. We go over these things. Ex pacto. What is that? Ex pacto. You're speaking Latin now. It's from an illegal contract. An action does not arise. Why? Because the contract's illegal. So it's ex pacto. It's illegal. So what would make an ex pacto contract, an adhesion contract? There's not full disclosure. Most of you sign adhesion contracts. There's not full disclosure. So you might be dealing with a misuser or a false judgment. What is a misuser? It's an unlawful use of a right. In cases of public offices, And corporations, a misuser is sufficient to cause the right to be forfeited. So someone that actually had a right, that right could be forfeited by a misuser. A misuser is a sufficient cause for the right to be forfeited. What is a false judgment? That's the name of a writ, which lies when a false judgment has been given in the court. A court barn or other court, not of record. That's a false judgment. That's from Bouvier's. You can find it in Bouvier's dictionary. What is a struck off? It's a case that is said to be struck off, where the court has no jurisdiction. So the case is struck off and can give no judgment. Why? Because the court didn't have jurisdiction. In order that the case be taken off the record, that is a struck off, which is actually done by an entry to that effect. That's a struck off. Or you can't hold this against me. I want a struck off. I want that case stricken from the record. What is a false return? Well, what are we dealing with? We're dealing with legal lease. We're trying to overcome aphasia. It's called aphasia, the inability to really comprehend these words. What is a false return? It's a return made by the sheriff, or other ministerial officers to a writ in which is actually stated a fact contrary to the truth. Just because it's a fact doesn't mean it's the truth. No, it's contrary to the truth. So he might be stating a fact, but the fact may not be pertinent in a particular case. So that's a false return. And so it's an injurious to one of the parties or someone having an interest in that case. So in this case, the officer is liable for damages to the party that he or she injured. Do you understand? That's a false return. Do you understand? It's ex nihilo. From nothing, nothing comes. It's a breach of trust. Many of you talk about trust law, right? What's a breach of trust? Does it mean I don't trust you anymore? It's any act. A breach of trust is any act done by a trustee contrary to the terms of his trust or in excess of his authority and to the detriment of the trust, or the wrongful omission by a trustee of any act required of him by the terms of the trust. Also, wrongful misappropriation by a trustee of any fund or property which had been lawfully committed to him in a fiduciary character. Every violation by a trustee of a duty which equally lays upon him, whatever willfully and fraudulently, is actually a breach of trust, whether it's done by, you know, willfully done, or whether it's done through negligence arising through mere oversight and forgetfulness, is actually a breach of trust. So the breach of trust would actually include every omission and commission and carrying out the trust according to its terms of care and diligence in protecting and investing the trust property and of using perfect good faith. What is a close? What is a close? C-L-O-S-E. I know what it means in common parlance. What does it mean in law? It signifies the entrance in the soil, and not merely a close or enclosure. So in the common acceptation of the term, so in every case where one man has a right to exclude another from his land, the law encircles it. So if not already enclosed with any imaginary fence. So that's a close. He has a right to prevent other people from coming on his land. That's a close. Do you understand? So these are words that we should know that we don't. So we deal with foreclosure and things of the like, and we don't know how to handle it because of aphasia. It's called aphasia. Pursuant, right? Check this out, right? Pursuant to 12 U.S. Code 95, right? Emergency limitations and restrictions on businesses, right? Of members of the Federal Reserve System, right? We're talking about the banks just now, right? Destinations of legal holidays for national banking association exceptions, state defined, right? In order to provide for the safer and more effective operation of the national banking system and the Federal Reserve to preserve for the people full benefits of the currency provided for by the Congress through the national banking system and the Federal Reserve system, and to relieve interstate commerce of the burdens and obstructions resulting from the recipient on an unsound or unsafe basis of deposit subjects to be withdrawn by check during such emergency periods as the President of the United States by proclamation may prescribe. And I quote in bold print, no member bank of the Federal Reserve System shall transact any banking business except to such extent and subject to such regulation, limitations, and restrictions as may be prescribed by the Secretary of Treasury with the approval of the President. An individual, partnership, corporation, or association, or any director, officer, or employee thereof violating any of the provisions of this section shall be deemed guilty of a misdemeanor, and upon conviction thereof shall be fined not more than $10,000, or if a natural person may be in addition to such fines, be imprisoned for a term not exceeding 10 years. Each day that any such violation continues shall be deemed a separate offense. So for each offense, this should happen to the bankster at the man defined, right? So you might want to have a look at that code. Is your banker violating that? So what is an act of man? Every man of sound mind and discretion is bound by his own acts. You're bound by your own acts. And the Lord does not permit him to do anything against it. So that means you can't be forced to go against your own act. And all acts are construed most strongly against him who does. So a man is not only bound by his own acts, but by those of others who acts or presume to act by his authority. So if you're not governing yourself, guess what? Someone else is going to govern government and is responsible civilly in all such cases. So if someone is acting in your stead, you're still responsible civilly in all such cases, even when there is but a presumption of authority. Even when there's just a presumption of authority, he may be made responsible criminally. Are you getting this? Are you getting this? Even if they're making presumptions, you could actually be made responsible criminally. Case in point, right? For example, right? Case in point. Let's say, for instance, right? Someone's selling books, right? Or music, right? He may be indicted for publishing a label which has actually been sold in his store. You see what I'm saying? By his regular salesman. You see what I'm saying? Be careful. Although he may possibly have no knowledge of it, but he's still held responsible. He may have no knowledge of it. And this is actually taken from what? from Bouvier's Law Dictionary, 6th edition. Go and check it out for yourselves. And so things like these is why it becomes continuously important to know the law, to know how these things work so that you could actually stand against them. Otherwise, you're going to be getting railroaded. A lot of these terms, hey, you might want to go back over and listen to them, check them out, listen to them a few times, and get them into your mindset. And so with that, I'm going to say peace, two fingers, shalom, Tazadaq is out.